Hey everyone, the name is Eric Dorr, and I believe that the cognitive functions that we talk about so frequently are not just cognitive. It's not just about neurons passing through each other in the brain. It's not just about network connections. But it's also the case that when you are engaging in certain levels of thinking, you have emotions that are processed and that help regulate this process. Emotions help drive cognitive processing. Often when we feel the most emotions, our cognitive processing is also at its highest. Often when people create the myth that you're either a thinker or an emotional feeling type, what they are doing is they are spewing on a misconception that there are people that, or there are networks in the brain that have no emotional implications on a person. Well, truth is, emotions are our primary reward system in the mind. They are what makes us feel good about what we do and what rewards us for what we do. So when we are being logical or when we are using our thinking networks, often we have satisfaction as the primary motivational factor to reward that level of thinking. Satisfaction that, yes, I've done something good, or that sense of pleasure when you've been able to overcome a goal, or when you've been able to get a higher profit or something similar to that. It's that emotions are playing a key role in how all of us think, and that means that we can build the Neo-Jungian Enneagram if we want to. We can make this wheel of emotions for the Neo-Jungian types and the functions, because each function has a different emotional implication, and I find that each type has a different way to relate to emotions. So talking about, for example, the NF types and their primary functions, you have stark differences in how they experience, not how much they feel, but in how they experience emotions. And the key thing you'll want to know is that the introverted, intuitive feeling types will share two similarities. First, they will be people that, on the average, have a high amount of, have an intense amount of feeling. In a sense that their emotion in our life is more intense, subtle, nuanced, and deep, often more hidden from the world around them. It's not that the INFP or the INFJ is outwardly expressive or emotional, or that they are affectionate people. Often the contrary, we are the people that tend to be a little more restrained with our emotions, that it's harder for us to access them, it takes more time, we need more time to process it. And also, when you look at INFJ and INFP, similarly with excitement, we don't show a lot of outwardly excitement over what we talk about. We can seem a little drier sometimes, but when it gets down to it, INFJs have something going for them that helps them in storytelling and in building up in public speaking like I do right now. And that is that we are good at creating anticipation for what we say, and that we don't have that sense of shyness that INFPs and ENFPs might have when it comes to public speaking. It's for us easier to engage other people. Even as introverted kids, INFJs tend to strike themselves out as being usually people that are very open to speaking to other people and to interacting and communicating and meeting new, making new friendships. It's that we don't have that shyness, in a sense, to keep us from that level of connection. I think that often for the INFJ, what you will notice is that the INFJ doesn't seem excited on the surface, and because it's under the surface, not visible clearly, it often becomes more like a visible sense of fascination. INFJs seem like they have this big fascination or fixation, something that they are working towards, a long-term goal or something that they are really excited about, but not in a way that they talk about it or share it with other people, but more that they seem like really fascinated and into it. INFJs and INFPs are people that are, on the average, more fascinated than excited. But that fascination is important because it helps you deep dive into an intellectual topic, and it also helps you when other things come up and when new ideas come up to return to old ideas and to pick them up and to keep working on them, to keep finding them interesting, even if there are changes and things happening around you. I think what you will find about the INFJ compared to the ENFJ is that both of these types have some form of anticipation to them. They have this cunning quality, like in their fascination and their how they show excitement. It's like they have this thing that they are really curious about, this specific goal, this long-term prospect. And often INFJs and ENFJs are the types that are the least hesitant to make changes in this prospect. And when the INFJ or the ENFJ makes changes, that fascination evaporates. INFJs and ENFJs that are the most fascinated and most into something are people that can remain on a goal and that can resist changes and adaptations and can keep themselves set. With a lot of the differences and similarities, you'll also find that if you compare the ENFP and the INFP, the INFPs and ENFPs strike themselves out by being much more curious than the NFJs. They have this quality where they are open to and they are curious about things happening around them. It's that they are curious about a new idea presented to them or a new opportunity that just came forward. Where the INFJ or the ENFJ seems less interested in the new prospect but can become more interested in it later on. Often the INFP or the ENFP can become interested in an idea or a possibility and then another one and then another one. Of course, that sense of being able to brainstorm and to be creative is key for the INFPs and the ENFPs. What you'll want to know when you study these emotional differences is also the sense of how they express love. But I noticed that NFJs are often very caring types. ENFJs are caring in the sense of, oh no, that's not good, I heard about that, that's terrible, how are you doing? Where the INFJ is caring in the sense of more of caring, but in a more sensitive or a more intense way. INFJs don't necessarily speak affectionately about someone who's in pain, but we sit by the other person and we listen and we feel bad when we share that moment with them. We are caring and we are showing care, but often in a less worthy fashion. INFJs can, of course, share some form of story or something that can help them, but even if they do, it's often not a personal story. It's often not in the sense of an immediately kind thing, but something that we think will help the other person as truth or as story or some kind of wisdom that we can share. The INFP and the ENFP are more concerned than caring types. They are people that worry about others, that spend a lot of time taking other people's feelings into account, that think, oh, how did that, did I say too much at that point? Did I hurt that person? Did I do something wrong there? INFPs and ENFPs show a lot of care and love in the sense that they are always taking other people's feelings into account and considering other people's perspectives. And here's a truth for a lot of INFJs and ENFJs, that sometimes you can be a little self-absorbed in the sense that you might forget about how the other person is feeling or how they're doing because you're not actively thinking about it or worry about it in the same sense. When you do know, you care and you help out, you do a lot to be there for the other person, often in very practical ways. I can do it by cooking or by cleaning or by bringing something or by doing something nice for the other person. But for the ENFP or the INFP, it's often about asking questions and sharing your concerns with the other person and helping them with bringing up issues and alerting them to problems and helping them out when something seems to be bothering them or when something seems to be wrong. Being that person that inviting other people to share their story or their issues with you so that they can get it off their chest and so that they can heal from it. INFPs and ENFPs tend to really invite other people to share, where the INFJs and ENFJs are often people that are, when they care about someone, they want to do something for them. They want to act, they want to do something in practice. And so you have it with all these types. huge differences in their emotions, and if we start writing them down deeper, and if we start making bigger practical definitions of how each cognitive function, from introverted feeling to introverted intuition to extroverted feeling to extroverted intuition, and we start digging down and what are the emotional drives behind this, then we will learn a lot about personality types that none other of the other systems have become aware of. So we have some work cut out for us. We need to start writing, we need to start getting these things down, and we need to start investigating this. And what we will have in the end is the Neo-Jungian Enneagram, a complete system of how each personality type processes and deals with emotion, and how they express and how they experience it, and how they can deal with negative emotions like shame or shyness or similar issues, and how they can become more integrated and respond to these in positive ways. So that's my thoughts on this topic, and I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, leave a like, share and subscribe, and as always, may your neurons be with you.